And I'm Raquel Ribeiro. I'm based in São Paulo, Brazil. And I'm an English teacher and teacher trainer. And I've been researching the integration of generative AI to practice. And that's what I'm going to share with you today.
And I'm Evelina. I'm based in Cambridge. So you have an international team today with Raquel in São Paulo and myself in Cambridge. I'm the director of the research group in Cambridge English, and I've been working in language education for about 30 years. And my latest passion is use of AI in language learning assessment and teaching. So without further ado, we'll get started. Raquel and I are going to focus, as you can see from the title, on using GenAI with Cambridge materials. But first, we'll open up with just defining what AI is and how AI has changed. So it's useful to go in with this knowledge. AI models are actually evolving. The good old-fashioned AI models were predictive models, as opposed to the new generation of models which we're working with now and using code that are generative models. So in a predictive model, for example, you could give photographs of animals to the AI model and say, identify the photo of a dog. And the AI model would select the photos of a dog. You could also, for example, give it something a student has written and ask the AI to classify that writing against a scale, for example, the Common European Framework of Reference. Or you could ask it to give information on the topic. You can say, for example, tell me the closest Brazilian restaurants in my neighborhood, and it would give you lots of links. Those are predictive models. They're very good at predicting information. The difference is that now the models are generating information. So instead of identifying the photo of a dog, they can actually, these models, create an image of a dog. Instead of classifying a learner script, they can actually write a learner script, write a learner essay. And instead of just finding information on a topic and giving you website links, they can actually write a recommendation for you. So this is the difference from predicting information to generating information. And these models can do much, much more than the examples we've given you through generating text, images, audio and video. So incredibly powerful technology, very, very disruptive technology as well. One of the differences of this technology is it's very widely accepted, widely available, and socially accepted. So should we be excited about these developments? Now, this technology brings a lot of value, a lot of opportunities for us as language teachers, and these are some ideas about what the biggest opportunities are. So one of the big advantages or big opportunities is that GenAI can actually become a study buddy. It can personalize learning. It can adapt learning to individual students' interests or levels or strengths and weaknesses. This technology can also be a teacher's assistant. So it can augment the intelligence of the teacher by being almost like a co-pilot, a teacher's collaborator. Generative AI can also create content. It can create materials at speed and at scale. So in the matter of seconds, it can produce large amounts of content. It can also bring a lot of creativity into our teaching because it can provide new images, new text, new audio, new video, and these are new insights that we wouldn't normally have necessarily. And also, it can push us to develop new skills through providing new task types and new success criteria. And Raquel will give you lots of examples of these opportunities when she gives you some insights into how to use this in the classroom. I want you to think about these now. So we've given these five opportunities a number, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. In the chat, tell us which are you most excited about? Which for you is the biggest opportunity that Gen AI brings to us in the classroom? So just type the number in the chat. Some people are giving us more than one answer. I guess you couldn't choose. It's really, really good to see the whole range of possibilities here. A lot of twos and threes, I have to say, which is something that definitely brings a lot of efficiency. Okay, thank you for engaging with this. Now, every powerful technology has two faces. amazing opportunity, but really significant risks that we have to be aware of. So should we be excited? Is one side of the coin. Should we be worried? In other words, what are the risks? What are the concerns we should have top of mind? One of the main ones that we should be aware of when using this technology is that it produces inaccurate, biased, and inappropriate content. I think we're all familiar now with the term digital hallucinations, and Raquel will pick up on that later when she talks about insights from the classroom. So the content produced at GenAI can be inaccurate, so it just gives wrong information, but it also can be biased and inappropriate. Another risk and concern is that this technology challenges assessment integrity because it can be used for cheating, basically, in assessment malpractice, in coursework, and also in assessment context. So that's something that we have to be aware of. Another concern relates to the question of intellectual property and copyright. So in other words, when this technology generates content, whose intellectual property is it? And whose copyright is it if we then use it again? So again, we need to be aware of this. Another challenge is the black box approach. In other words, this technology is a black box. It might produce amazing content, but we do not know how it got there. So the explainability of the features it uses, the processes, is a challenge. And explainability of AI is quite a significant area for us to be aware of. Another concern that this technology brings is that it is actually just a machine. We have to remember that. It produces content very confidently. It gives opinions in a really competently looking manner, but it has no understanding of the real world. We must remember that. And finally, another risk, another concern, is that AI innovation often outpaces education systems. The rate of reform in education systems tends to be slow. AI innovation outpaces it, which means that some of the risks and concerns might be not addressed and might create issues in education systems. And so these are just some issues to be aware of. Again, let's think about them together. So there's a number against each one of these. Which for you is the biggest concern around using Gen AI? So which is your top concern when using Gen AI? Again, pick a number. I saw somebody had lots of fives in their response. It is, after all, just a machine. I see a lot of ones and twos. But again, concerns across the board. So as a first step in understanding these concerns better and tapping into the opportunities are webinars like these. So let's move on. Keep those opportunities and concerns in mind beyond the webinar as well. So what we're going to do is I will very quickly share with you insights that we have gathered from teachers through surveys and focus groups. And then Raquel is going to give you some examples from the classroom. So just very quickly, let's take a look at what teachers, language teachers, have told us about how they use AI, what their experiences are, and what their attitudes are. And this is a project that was done by Cambridge and the University of Bedfordshire. We collaborated with researchers in that team. So here's what we found through the research that we did with those teachers. First of all, who were the teachers? We surveyed very broadly, and we collected data and insights from surveys and focus groups, as I said, with teachers from around the world. We had 386 teachers spread in 70 countries. They represented primary, secondary, and adult education. They worked in small class sizes in private schools and large classes in state schools. So quite a broad sample of teachers. And four themes emerged from the insights that they shared with us. The first one is that there was really strong uptake and positive attitudes. Now, we did this research last summer. ChatGPT had been released 6 months previously. So it took only 6 months for the teachers to really report frequent use of GenAI tools and to express highly positive attitudes. So they were quickly taking up this technology, which highlighted the integral role they assigned to GenAI in language education. Here's what one teacher from Hungary told us. The teacher said, "I think it's essential that we keep up with the development of AI and incorporate it into our everyday teaching." So it's an essential skill to be able to use this tool. And in fact, 71% of our teachers said that they use it weekly or monthly. That's a very high percentage. Another theme that emerged is that the teachers were using this technology as a teaching assistant and their work buddy. So they were mostly using GenAI to generate teaching ideas and adapt learning materials to diverse student abilities, but they also told us that they use it to reduce their workload and to enable more personalized learning. So they're using it for efficiency, to reduce their workload and focus on the areas that they uniquely can do, and they were delegating work to the AI. So one teacher told us that he or she told my students to think of it as a tutor. Anything they would ask me, they can ask the technology. Another theme that emerged, but the teachers also told us that it is not all for the AI to do. The skill, the choice, the decision, it is still under our own responsibility. AI is not going to solve the way in which we learn or in which we teach. So we saw this varied view that yes, teachers are delegating work to the AI, Gen AI tools, but also they see that they have an integral role in using this technology. Another theme that emerged were the challenges and concerns. It wasn't all positive, of course, there were many, many challenges. And they identified, similar to you actually, that cheating and plagiarism, so assessment integrity being challenged, were seen as major challenges, as well as diminishing critical thinking skills, actually. This is just a machine, and yet it's being used by students in a way that possibly leads to shallow learning. So this is what a teacher from Ecuador said. Sometimes students tend to look for answers on ChatGPT instead of analyzing and thinking critically. So students would take a shortcut instead of analyzing themselves. So they saw these as quite significant challenges for them. And the final theme that emerged is that they were facing a lot of training hurdles, and they had strong professional development needs. What we found is that there was very high demand for training that signaled the teachers' strong desire to learn how to use GenAI well, but at the same time there was limited professional development opportunities for them. So these were key themes that emerged. As one teacher said, any teacher who is not using GenAI is behind. So this webinar, of course, contributes to this opportunities for professional development. Okay, so I've told you a little bit about the big picture behind GenAI, a little bit about insights from teachers, and now let's hand over to Raquel, who is going to give you a lot of insights from using this technology in the classroom. Raquel, over to you.
Thank you. Well, let's take a look from the perspective of a teacher. I will bring you examples from my classes with the different age ranges from a real classroom. It's important to tell you that the perspective I'm choosing here is based on my research using AI integrated to the lesson content. So there's a course book and a theme, and I kept that, and I just found a way to integrate using AI technology, generative AI mostly, with the lesson content. And this is very important to keep in mind. The second thing is that the perspective I've chosen is a perspective where the students have to interact with the generative AI. And throughout the process, which lasted for a year, two semesters, from February last year up to November, and with teenagers and adults, young adults, and also the young learners. So it's important to keep this in mind. Well, I'm going to get started with the young learners. And of course, with the young learners, they are not allowed to have accounts or to use their mobile phones in class or to have any sort of generative AI account. So I had to find a way around that. So I decided to use the conversational AI, which is simpler and straight to the point. The context I had here in this class in particular was a group of 9-year-olds. So imagine that in a school, and we were studying about the time, how to speak the time, what time is it? And then one of them asked me, because they believed that all the countries have the same time, like it would be the same time in Brazil and everywhere else. And I just found that so interesting. And I said, well, maybe not really, we have to check. I only had my mobile phone. And then I thought, well, there's an activity I can develop here. And with the conversational AI, the tool I used was Google Assistant. This is a simple tool, and basically it responds to speech and text and understands simple commands and words. So after a huge classroom management, because that's super important, so that they would understand the point, I asked them to think of all the places in the world, and then I guided them through cities in different continents. Each one of them was supposed to ask the question, and as a group, we would understand the answer. So I'm going to show you now a very short video of the children interacting with the AI. Let's go.
What time is it in Nairobi?
The time in Nairobi, Kenya, is 4:29 p.m.
What is the time? 4:39 p.m.
P.m. means?
Afternoon.
Right. And where is Nairobi?
Kenya.
That's right.
What time is it in Beijing?
The time in Beijing, China, is 9:30 p.m.
9:30 p.m.
P.m. here means?
Night.
And where is Beijing?
China.
All right. Next.
What time is it in Buenos Aires?
The time in Buenos Aires, Argentina, is 10:30 a.m.
10:30 a.m.
A.m. means?
Morning.
In the morning. Very well. So here you can see there's all the background noise of a class, of a school. And they were taking turns. I guess you could see the little fingers. And they had to ask about different cities. There was chorus repetition. And it gave me the opportunity to expand on the content. So the cities, the countries, AM, PM, right? So this is one example to use with young learners. Now I'd like to ask you in the comments, please, considering children, the context of teaching children, could you suggest all the questions that they could ask the AI bot? Which type of questions? So I'd like you to type, and I'm going to take a look here at the comments, okay? Which questions would you as a teacher create so the children would ask the bot? I'm following here something about animals, the temperature, the weather, cities, cattles, colors. Thank you so much. Flags, food, cattles. History. Thank you so much. Exactly. So we are the ones, the teachers, we are the ones who decide and guide our learners. And it's super important to mention here that apart from classroom management, there is also some negotiation with the children. And of course, I didn't film them. This is also shared with the parents because they can listen and recognize the child's names when they're speaking, the child's voice, and that's super cute. When we consider teenage learners, the context changes because there is not only one mobile phone now, but some. And then I use this BYOD approach. Do you know what that stands for? I believe so. It's a way to work collaboratively. If someone could please write what BYOD stands for, thank you. Yeah, it means bring your own device. So it is a moment when you use the mobile phones from your students. And of course, we usually have a context. Thank you very much for sharing that. It's so important. And then we have a group with three, four students on average, and they work collaboratively. Very well. I had a lesson theme for a group of teenagers aged in between 14 to 16, mostly. In this group, I had a 17-year-old as well. And the theme was leadership related to the world of work. Well, it is complicated and they are not able to come up with things on their own. So I decided to share with them this opportunity of using generative AI to gather more information about it. So the feature I used here is the text generation. And personally, as an English language teacher in a context where we are learning English as a foreign language, every opportunity to speak and to listen is precious in our development. The idea is that ChatGPT, for example, or Google Bard, they are able to answer questions in this human-like language, and they come up with ideas, and these are more structured. Very well, I'm going to show you one example of the teenage group interacting with ChatGPT within the context of their lesson.
What are the main leadership characteristics that millennials present? Tell me in two paragraphs.
Very well. I feel so proud. I can't help it. They know they've got one mobile, maybe two mobiles per group. So they learn to synchronize. We develop a whole way of working. And there is this question. And I'm the one to come up with the question, tell them, okay, here's the question to use in order to save time. Well, and talking about the teacher coming up with the question, it is so important to understand this concept of prompting. And the explanation is to basically, in a very, very straightforward way, to give an instruction to an artificial intelligence. And if the instruction is prompted properly in terms of number of paragraphs, for example, and topic, chances are we are going to have better material to work with. When they ask the question, there comes the answer. And the answer, even though we guide it through the prompting, it can be a long answer. And there is something, there's a process that we go through with that. For adult learners, we also use the BYOD, which stands for the bring your own device approach, because it's possible, and also the collaboration in groups. The idea of using either ChatGPT or Bard is, you know, if the choice of generative AI is given to the students. What I usually have is that some of them choose one and some groups choose the other and they collaborate, and that's really great. I invite you, if you haven't, see if you can access on your own ChatGPT or Google Bard if you haven't experienced yet. Another thing that we need to point out when working with teenagers and adult learners, that happens in everyday classes. We have latecomers for a number of reasons. I'm talking about in-person classes and also the remote online classes. People sometimes access the class link slightly later. There are students who require slightly longer to follow. Maybe they have some hearing difficulties. And working in a group, I have observed throughout the year of 2023, working with teenagers, young adults, and adults, that this group collaboration also helps in this sense. I would like to invite you now You don't have to type in the chat at this moment, but the topic here, the theme of our class was related to the workforce. And I decided to focus on encouraging and frightening views on the future of the workforce. It's very challenging. It's a very challenging topic. So what I did, I divided the class in groups, in smaller groups, and half of the groups would be in charge of focusing on encouraging aspects and the other half on the frightening aspects, because later on, my plan is to have one student from each group pair up, forming another pattern of interaction. And if this is online, it's just to send them to breakout rooms so that they could exchange ideas, speak based on the research. I have also observed that there is a level of confidence that comes along with that. So I'd like you to think, if you had the same topic, workforce, encouraging and frightening views, how would you structure your prompt? Well, this is how I structured my prompt. I use Google Classroom, which is a learning platform. It's free, to communicate with my students every class throughout the class. So what I usually do, I share with them and they access that on mobile, and this element of social media, messaging, replying also adds an important dynamics to the learning process. If you have used any platform or any Google Docs or any Microsoft document, anything, you can also share. That's important because we learn so much from each other. And why is that? For the same purpose, if somebody arrives late or missed the class, they can access that and they understand, okay, that's what the class is doing. This is our focus right now. Very well. So the instructions were here and they had to go about it. Let's check.
To tell me six encouraging views on the future of the workforce.
It's interesting. I can't help but feel so proud of them. As we integrate generative AI with a purpose throughout the classes, and not every class, but this is not something we do once and then never again. It becomes part of the class, the steps we follow during the classes. They also develop their ways of work. And while they are working, we as teachers, we can step back for a while, monitor, give assistance, and observe our students actively working and exchanging ideas. So this is a very core belief I have when using generative AI, that our learners have to do the task with our guidance, and this brings benefits. So for example, this question they asked here, it could have been written, but I personally, and I share that with them, that I see more benefits in trying to speak. If it happens that for any reason, the machine is not able to understand, okay, then you go and type it. It's not a big deal, but it's important to share with them the benefits of doing so. Remember, they asked the question. Well, then there comes the answer. What happens is the generative AI brings more elaborate answers and ideas like this.
Sure. Here are six frightening views on the future of the workforce. 1. Mass unemployment. As automation and artificial intelligence, AI, continue to advance, they are expected to replace many jobs. Some estimates suggest that up to 800 million jobs could be lost to automation by 2030.
I'm going to just make a comment in this point. The generative AI is going to keep saying lots of things, even though we try to say a number of bullet points or paragraphs. And I teach them every time they see an idea and they say, oh, we can use that to answer. Well, that's interesting information, or that's a new word or a new sentence. I ask them to pause it. And as a group, the person who is in charge of the mobile phone copies not everything, but the very key point. And then they have like a document for the group where they are actually choosing from the information what to share. And not only choosing what to share, but also we are going to do something later, which I usually tell them is a double checking, because there's no ways we can trust AI blindly. And that's why those steps are so important. While they are listening.
Sure, here are six frightening views on the future of the workforce.
This helps especially the learners with more difficulties in the listening. They also learn other words and different ways to organize the sentences. Remember, I told you that I use Google Classroom to share the steps with my learners. The guidance is always here, and now we have a continuation of that integrated to the course material. So it's not like you are going to have an AI-based class. The whole point is that the book brings information and the research can help them expand their vocabulary, can enhance the possibility of exchanging ideas and having this aspect of digital citizenship, also learning how to use it, self-reflection, and also critical thinking. But the integration with the course content, the lesson is there. And you know, if you teach teenagers and even young adults and adults, nowadays we multitask through screens because we've got to. An important step after they go about the research is to share their perspectives. This is a preparation, literally, so that when they have to talk to the person from the other thing, they have something to rely on. So this can be here on mobile, because remember I told you, absentees, or if they need to revise something. There are students who meanwhile just copy things, and that's okay too. What matters is that they are interacting with the content. And here, when they share that, it is the content plus their very own perceptions. And that also develops a sense of digital citizenship, where you have to think before you actually share something in a social media, just that this social media is just for us in the class. And I would like to highlight here how interesting it is, the way they express it. A torn between the benefits of we agree to a certain extent, disagree with the sentence, and then they point it out. Both agree to a certain extent, discussed about. It's so interesting. And this is also proof when parents need to understand, okay, is my son, in the case of teenagers, of course, is my son or daughter taking part? So when I have this talk with the parents, I always have evidence because it's there. I showed you examples with the young learners, teenagers, and the adults. And I would like to make a comment now in terms of the appropriacy according to the CEFR. And from my experience, I recommend conversational AI, the bot, like I mentioned, Google Assistant or even Alexa, for the elementary level students, be them adults or children, because you have a straightforward type of interaction that also brings a challenge. And as for B1 onwards, considering the CEFR, the levels that classify students into elementary learners, independent learners, and proficient learners, the text creation tool is more recommended because it challenges them further. And again, if possible, using this feature to listen to what is being presented. But, like mentioned by Evelina earlier in the very beginning, we have to be careful because there are hallucinations. And how to deal with that? Well, first we need to understand this context in terms of hallucinations and generative AI. So simply stating, when artificial intelligence hallucinates, it produces false information. And when I share that with my students, it's like they say, okay, excuse me, so are you telling us that we cannot really trust that? Remember back in 2022, November, December, all the discussions about plagiarism and how students would use that. They had their plans. And I said, yes, that's precisely what I'm telling you. So for this reason, it is really important to fact check the information, to double check. You cannot trust blindly all the output of information from AI. And I clearly remember the groups looking at me like, we thought that would be just super amazing. I said, it is still, but let's establish some important steps. And here you see it's the photo of a board, and we co-created and revised the steps we had been using. And one of the steps here is to double check the generated content to check if the information is trustworthy. So before they actually go and type the information in Google Classroom, they have this moment. They select the things they consider important. Then they double check with trustworthy sources, sites. And then if they say, okay, this makes sense, they need to keep this where they use to double check the information so that they can prove that it's not only generative AI based. So fact checking and also choosing what to share. Remember, it's important to develop the digital citizenship in our students, this self-reflection, discussing and exchanging ideas, and obviously the critical thinking. Well, here's another example of me using generative AI with them and some other steps. And this was the prompt: to ask the generative AI to create a four-slide presentation. That was, woohoo! They were, you're going to teach us that? You know we are going to use this with all the subjects. I said, okay, let's understand how to go about it. Remember, I had previously asked them to select the information, what they considered more important, and then to fact check that. I said, okay, now you are going to type, create a four-slide presentation with these prompts. And the prompts were exactly the paragraphs that they had selected previously. And then, obviously, generative AI came up not with the slides, backgrounds and photos, but with the slide organization. And I clearly remember they were like, whoa. And I said, whoa, but you have to work with that. So you have the slides. Have you double checked all the information? Because I stress this throughout the classes. Now, with Google Slides or Canvas or any other feature, you have to illustrate those slides because you are going to have impromptu presentations in smaller groups using your slides. It is very challenging for teenagers and adults to have to come up with a small presentation and not very comfortably in a laptop or on a mobile phone. But I always trust my students' ability to overcome the challenges, and I learn so much from them. They organize the slides together, and something that was even more important than that, they were presenting using the very small screen. And this is also so very important for the shy students who feel insecure. So instead of asking them at first to go to the front of the class and present, we just had it slowly. And in the very end, they had to go to the front of the class because as a teacher, we always have an agenda. In one of the presentations, in the last slide to show the sources, I just found it so interesting that the group wrote to double check because teacher insists so much on that. By the end, November, early December, I decided to listen what they had to say. So I conducted an anonymous search where what I wanted to see was, in their own words, their perceptions of having worked with generative AI throughout the lessons. And I'd like to highlight some of these comments and share with you. So there is a comment that pointed out here that they liked how they are free to assert and mentioning the word autonomy. This is so important to have, to be there more active in the process. That's what I mean. Another comment here mentions the PowerPoint slides, discussing important issues, you know, the topics brought to class. There's another one, and so interesting, their perception. We had a conversation with ChatGPT, Google Bard. We could learn more because it allowed us to facilitate our searches, but it can hallucinate. Well, we double checked. And it's so interesting because I see by showing and constantly exchanging ideas, they get to understand the concept. And that's so precious, you know. And I would like to conclude this part of sharing with you my students' journey and some parts of this journey by sharing something that I learned as a teacher in the classroom, because I'm an English teacher, I'm a teacher trainer and writer, but everything comes from the real classroom interaction. And I have learned that blending this educational context and the knowledge and creativity to overcome difficulties of maybe not having the best internet connection or one device per student, but it is important to integrate it when possible with the lessons so that we can enhance our students' learning experience. That's really, really important.
Raquel, thank you so much. As you were talking, I was just looking at the chat and words like cool, amazing, brilliant, fantastic were appearing as comments to the ideas that you shared. I hope you did learn a lot from this. I did, from Raquel's very practical tips. So we're just wrapping up really the presentation now. What can you do today? What are some specific things that you can be doing? Well, we believe that you... if we go to the next slide, sorry. So how can you become AI ready? There are many things you can do, but really we believe the most important is to seek out professional development opportunities. As you're doing with this webinar, really proactively look for opportunities to further your ideas and to better understand what this technology can do. Another important aspect of becoming AI ready is to really understand what AI can and can't do so that you can critically engage with Gen AI and your students can critically engage with it as well. Very, very important. Another aspect of becoming AI ready is to learn how to delegate work to the AI so that you're working smarter, not harder. And really using the technology where it adds value is a very important part of becoming AI ready. Another aspect of becoming AI ready is really learning to write, learning how to write good prompts. Raquel demonstrated a few times the prompts that her students were using. It's really important for you to learn how to be good at that and for your students to learn how to write good prompts as well. And finally, really to learn together. Be part of a community as we are today. We've got teachers from around the world sharing ideas. So learn with your colleagues, with your students, with your children. They can really give you useful insights. So we just have a little bit of information for you on how to write a good prompt. And I wanted to give credit to one of the colleagues that I work with here at Cambridge University Press and Assessment, Sam Oliver. So this is just some ideas on how to write a successful prompt. And we're going to produce a blog and more information on this. But the first step that you need to think about when you write a successful prompt is to provide the role description. So tell the bot, tell the technology what it is. So for example, you're an English language teacher. So create that role for it. Provide very clear instructions. Just like you have to give clear instructions in the classroom to your students, you have to do the same with the Gen AI tool. So very clear instructions on what you wanted to do, write, explain, edit, and so on. Provide contextual information so that it understands what the context is, but don't enter any identifying detail about your students. This is important. Raquel used the expression digital citizenship, and this is part of digital citizenship, knowing what to share with the machine, what not. So provide context, but only with suitable information. For example, the focus of the class is developing a presentation on unusual foods. Another step of writing a successful prompt is to input any content that you're using. So if, for example, you're providing some information to the Gen AI tool to use, input that content now. But of course, be careful with entering copyrighted content. If something clearly belongs to someone else, be careful about how you use that. Another step of writing a successful prompt is to provide examples for the technology, for the machine to use. So that it knows what output you're looking for. For example, you can say, when you develop the quiz, I'd like you to use questions like this. Another aspect of a successful prompt is to use cues and formats. So tell it how you want the content to be developed. Do you want bullet points? Do you want it to be appropriate for beginner level English? Give it information about that. And finally, allow it to ask questions. So explicitly make it clear that it is okay to admit that it doesn't know something. So instead of producing hallucinations, it can say, I don't know about this. So these are just some ideas on how that you can follow in on writing a successful prompt. And if you'd like to find out more, if you're curious about the ideas we talked about today, there are blogs and position papers and podcasts on the Cambridge website. The blogs give a lot of practical advice, but we think it's also important for you to not just get practical tips, you know, top 10 tips on Gen AI, but also to understand more about the broader questions, the challenges, the concerns, the risks, and the opportunities, and that you can get through position papers and our podcasts. And also, we wanted to flag a really, really excellent paper by UNESCO, which is on the screen as well, on guidance on Gen AI in education and research. So that's another resource that we think would be useful for you to look at if you would like to find out more. So we're going to finish with a final thought. This is from three well-known educationalists, Hamilton, William, and Hattie. And here's what they said, talking about Gen AI. They said that the best current chess players are not humans, nor machines, but humans working with machines to figure out the best move. And so our final thought to you is, how are you going to work with the machine to figure out your best move? And with that note, we shall say thank you very much. And we have about 5-6 minutes for questions if you'd like to ask us anything that is a question, comment, you're welcome to share that with us.
Thank you so much, both of you. I think, as you said, Evelina, there's been comments throughout saying, amazing. I saw one in the Q&A box that came up that said, this webinar has changed my life, which is a huge thing to say.
But actually, I think we're at a point in our lives and in our careers when this technology is that transformational. And if you use it well, it does change fundamentally how you approach your teaching. So it's so wonderful to hear that comment.
Yeah. And yeah, as you say, it does change everything. And as you pointed out at the start of the webinar, there are also some fears about it. And these have also come through in some of the questions and comments. So we've had a few that have talking about balancing the next generation with this amazing technology, but are we also at the same time making them less creative? Are we affecting their ability to use critical thinking, or can we bring them together?
Raquel, what do you, shall I open to you?
I guess that because it's on our mindset that the teacher is the one guiding the process. So we encourage via prompts, and all the time we guide our learners to work with the results, select and fact check. So in this sense, we are not telling the AI to be in charge of everything. So we are encouraging and developing that further.
I agree. I mean, Raquel gave perfect examples on how you can develop critical thinking with the technology. It's how you use it, really. So even something as simple as asking GenAI, let's say ChatGPT, to write a 3-paragraph essay. So you're not asking your students to do that. You're telling them to ask the machine to do it, but then you ask them to engage with the essay, to critique it, to make it better, to check the facts. Even something as simple as that develops critical thinking and uses what the machine can bring into the classroom.
So everything as a support and a task for interaction. And I strongly recommend having this also going to the step of registering in writing somehow. They're very quick. We are all very quick to copy paste here and adjust things, and also use that to speak and to blend it with our very own opinions as well.
Okay, so if anything, it's almost an opportunity to create a new skill, that fact-checking, that
comparison. Teachers are essential.
Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. And you just... Sorry,
that's a good point. It is about creating new skills, developing new skills in you and in your students.
And you just mentioned there briefly, Raquel, writing. There's been some questions about that. So, it's... we can see how we can get information and check information and ideas. But in terms of if you're setting a piece of writing, especially in the context of learning English, should we ban using AI or ChatGPT for writing specifically?
I personally, I have used it for the classroom moments, but I would recommend using that for brainstorming. And I did that in terms of writing tasks. So in the preparation to engage them to the topic they have to produce, so all the part of engagement and brainstorming a few ideas, I did that with them so they would understand, okay, this is where you start from, and those are the steps you are going to use to develop it, you know. And then something else I added to the procedure is that they had to explain not only the writing, but also say, okay, these were the ideas I got from the artificial intelligence, and these were my ideas.
I think that's a good point to be. I don't think we should ban it. I think that is completely the wrong approach. It's about how you integrate it successfully. And as Raquel said, one of the approaches to integrating it is transparency. You know, we can't pretend our students are not going to use it. They will. So let's teach them how to use it well and be transparent about how they used this technology.
Brilliant. And that links very nicely to this next question. It's looking at grading and assessment. So if we're adapting how students are doing their tasks by using this technology. Is this something that we should really look at when we're grading students' work? Should that be part of what we're assessing them on, using this technology or gathering their ideas?
So I think we're at a very interesting time when this technology is pushing us to evaluate what assessment is. So, for example, I mean, here's a question for everyone. Are we going to ask students to write a 5-paragraph essay if the machine can do that? You know, that's a good question. And it's actually not about the essay. It's not about the task. It's about the skills we're trying to develop and assess. So that'll remain the skills of organizing a piece of writing, organizing main ideas and details, organizing a story. Those skills will remain. But how we get to that, what we ask our students to do might change. So it could be that we ask them to write an essay with the machine, to use the machine alongside their own ideas. So, you know, the tasks we use could evolve, or it could be that the idea of summative assessment becomes more restricted, that much more of the assessment will become formative using the technology as we go along to gather information about what someone can and can't do. So I think this, it's really pushing us to rethink what assessment tasks are going to be. And I think there'll be some big changes in the next 5 to 10 years.
Very exciting. Be amazing to keep talking to teachers and seeing how they're using it and seeing how it's changing and how it affects what they teach, as well as, like you say, the skills and how they teach them.
That's right. As we are. That's, I mean, that really is what we do very much. You know, we put a lot of value into that at Cambridge. We do talk to teachers. And Raquel and I are doing a double act, you know, a teacher from the classroom and someone in Cambridge who works on this area.
So exactly.
Perfect collaboration.
And I really believe in collaboration in every sense, in these opportunities, in teacher groups and exchanging ideas. You know, there are some questions here about how the tool I use to generate the PowerPoint. I see a number of questions, so I'm just going to take this opportunity. Actually, it was up to my students. They realized that ChatGPT generated the slides content more efficiently. So they use ChatGPT. And once ChatGPT generated the 4 slides, because that wasn't the prompt as part of the instructions, they chose how to actually create the slide layout. Some of them used Google Slides, so they went to the app, opened a slide, and quickly worked through a background and adding images. There were others who chose to use Canvas. So it was totally up to them.
Brilliant. Okay, thank you so much. I think that's probably all we've got time for, but if I could just take this opportunity to thank everybody who's joined us today, such enthusiastic participation throughout the entire webinar. And thank you so much for your amazing insights and expertise, Evelina and Raquel. It's been really, really informative. Thank you so much.